Not that long ago, a fairly broad consensus seemed to exist in favor of carbon taxes, a tool preferred by economists for curbing emissions. But the political tide may have turned, renewing the conversation about, if not carbon taxes, then what? Energy economist Mark Jaccard recommends flexible regulations, or FlexRegs. He is professor of sustainable energy at Simon Fraser University, co-author of the book Hot Air, Canada's Climate Change Challenge, and he joins us now via Skype from Vancouver, British Columbia. Mark, it's good to have you on TVO tonight. How are you doing?
Just fine, thank you. Thanks for having me.
Not at all. I want to just start by reading an excerpt from a piece you wrote for the Globe and Mail last month, and it goes like this. Carbon pricing is not essential to stop burning coal and gasoline. We economists only say it is because we prefer it. If we were honest, we would explain that decarbonization can be achieved entirely with regulations. These will cost more, but not a great deal more, if policymakers use flexible regulations, or FlexRegs, that allow companies and individuals to determine their cheapest way to decarbonize. Okay, a lot to unpack there, so let's get into this. Tell us off the top why you think economists, as a rule, prefer carbon taxes to regulations.
We prefer that because a lot of research consistently shows that a price on emissions, so that shows up as a tax on gasoline or natural gas for heating or coal, gives a firm or a household the greatest opportunity to decide how they want to respond to that price. And so they could end up saying, well, I'm going to use my car less, or I'm going to switch to transit, or I'm going to buy an electric car or use biofuels, or I'm going to not do anything differently because I really value this car or truck that I have. And that when you allow every firm or household to respond in the way that's best for it, then throughout the entire economy, you actually reduce emissions at the lowest possible cost. And economists have shown this not just with carbon dioxide, the major greenhouse gas from burning coal, oil, and gas. They've shown it with other pollutants as well.
Okay, that's the economic argument. Let's look at the political side of things, because obviously the current federal government agrees with that approach and has brought in a carbon tax, which started at the beginning of this year. If, as you tell us, regulations can get us where we need to go, and given that governments are usually loath to bring in new taxes because they're often unpopular, why do you suppose the current federal government has opted for a carbon tax instead of the regulation approach?
I'm glad that you worded your question that way, and I'm going to revamp your question a little bit, or its premise, because I've heard this so much. It's part of the debate out there, this language that the federal government has opted for a carbon pricing approach. They have not. If any independent modeler looks at the slate of policies, the portfolio of policies that the federal government has been putting together over the last 3 years, carbon pricing plays the tiniest, a very small role. With the current policies that are there now, carbon pricing would do about 15% of the lifting to get the reductions in the 2030 agreement period, which is what we agreed to at Paris. Instead, the federal government is phasing out coal plants. That's huge. They're putting in methane regulations on industry, leaks of methane, which is a potent greenhouse gas. They're putting in a low-carbon fuel standard, which they say will get another 30 megatons from all different uses of fuels. So, in fact, the federal government has not been relying on carbon pricing. This is a myth. And they partly said that. They've said this is really important to us, but they haven't put in a price that would do that. And then people who are opposed to carbon pricing have focused exclusively on the carbon price, which led all of us, and perhaps you as well, to assume that, oh, they must be depending on carbon pricing, which they're not.
Well, if it's only 15% of the lift, and it sure seems this day, or it seems these days, as if that 15% represents about 100% of the political cost of doing it, why bother doing it?
That's why I wrote the Globe and Mail op-ed. And it's also why, so I've been in this game for quite a long time. I helped to design the British Columbia carbon tax of 12 years ago. I have done policy work 10 years before that. And even 10 years ago or 11 years ago when Stéphane Dion met with different people across the country. He came and met with me, and I said to him, and he asked, you know, shouldn't I do this carbon tax? And I said, absolutely not. You will lose the election. A carbon price might be a good policy from an economic efficiency point of view, but it's bad politics. It puts a bullseye on your back and enables insincere politicians who really don't intend to do anything, to talk about how this is ruining the economy and making life impossible for suburban people that need to get the kids to hockey practice and so on. And then that is exactly what Stephen Harper did and won the election. So I was quite shocked when Trudeau's advisors and Trudeau still thought, oh, well, it's a new era and we'll put this carbon price on. A lot of Canadians support carbon pricing, but in a first-past-the-post electoral system, you only need to convince sort of 3 to 5% of swing voters in key suburban ridings that they should vote to get rid of this, and you can win an election in Canada.
So is that to say that you actually prefer the approach that, for example, Premier Doug Ford, that the leader of the United Conservative Party in Alberta, Jason Kenney, that the leader of the federal opposition, Andrew Scheer, you prefer the approach that they're taking to fighting climate change?
Well, I'm glad you asked me that, too, because no. What the problem with putting a carbon price on is, as I said a little bit earlier, it enables insincere politicians to say, oh, we'll get rid of that, but we'll still reduce greenhouse gas emissions. So the reason I'm using the word insincere is because climate policy is really difficult all over the world, and we've been failing mostly for three decades. And we've partly been failing because it's easy for politicians to fake it. And I don't want to put too fine a point on it, but Stephen Harper said, oh, I'm going to do regulations instead of Stéphane Dion's carbon pricing. And then he allowed those regulations to drag on for about a decade with nothing happening. And so it made it look like he was acting to reduce greenhouse gases, but he wasn't. When Gordon Campbell put in a carbon price in British Columbia 12 years ago, I was also involved in designing for him a regulation that stopped coal plants in the electricity sector, a low-carbon fuel standard that copied California. So what I'm saying is, or what I feel like I'm seeing across Canada, is that the carbon price is enabling politicians who are really not going to do anything to win by saying, we won't do a carbon price, we'll do something better. And then, but they should be able to lay out exactly, oh, we're going to keep the coal plant phase out, we're going to ramp up the low carbon fuel standard, we're going to copy Quebec's zero emission vehicle standard right across the country. But they're not saying that. And it's a very familiar script.
So let's stop talking about insincere politicians and start talking about sincere Simon Fraser University professors who have something called FlexRegs, or flexible regulations, that could offer a different path. What do you see as that?
Right. And so what I'm doing is just giving a name to something that is being implemented everywhere. Let's just look at electricity. The two key sectors that we can act on in Canada are electricity and transportation. And so I'm going to focus on those two sectors, but you can also do things in buildings. And well, we are doing the federal government's calling it pricing, output-based pricing in industry, but it's a lot of us would call it a kind of regulation. But these are regulations that also try to be economically efficient, if possible, by, again, giving all of that choice to households and firms. So if we look at the electricity sector, for example, in British Columbia, we implemented a clean electricity standard. This is, again, 10 years ago, and it meant that two coal plants that BC Hydro had signed contracts for did not get built. A natural gas plant did not get built. And then what we did is we had competition to see what renewables would replace them. We didn't say we must have this renewable or that renewable. We allowed the market forces to determine that. Alberta right now is phasing out its coal plants And this is a way more important policy than Rachel Notley's carbon price. And that phase out of the coal plants, then she's allowing competition to happen to determine if it's wind, if it's solar, if it's biomass, if it's hydropower that will replace the coal. If I move to transportation just briefly,
sure.
Quebec has a zero emission vehicle standard. British Columbia is about to implement that. It says it doesn't say you have to go to electric vehicles, or you have to go to hydrogen vehicles, or you have to go to biofuel vehicles. It says, let the market decide that, but we know we have to stop burning gasoline in our cars, so let's put in a regulation that phases in that requirement over time, but it does it flexibly. So that's what I mean, and those are the two sectors I would give as the example for what is called a flexible regulation. And just to point out, that is what we're doing. California, for example, major leader in North America, in the world, in reducing emissions. And our calculations and colleagues of mine in the United States is that about 85% of the reductions that California is doing are coming from flexible regulations and some other regulations, not from carbon pricing. I did the same analysis for Alberta. So it's what we're actually doing.
Mark, doesn't that presuppose, though, that the people of Quebec want to buy zero emission cars? And isn't the problem with that assumption that there's actually not much evidence that people are prepared to do that? They still seem to love their internal combustion engine SUVs and pickup trucks, right?
Absolutely. You mentioned one book I wrote 10 years ago. I also wrote another book called Sustainable Fossil Fuels. Fossil fuels are fantastic. They have done so much for humanity. And so we shouldn't assume that we can just easily move away from them. But we have to stop burning them. And we've known that for 30 years, and we've been implementing policies to do that. So the policies still have to do the same kind of thing that a carbon price does. They have to make it more expensive to buy one thing rather than another. And I'll give you an example of that. The zero emission vehicle standard that Quebec has, and as I say, when California really started that policy, what it does is it says to vehicle sellers, you have to have a rising share of zero emission vehicles over time, or you will pay this much penalty per car. So what happens is the retailers, the sellers of manufacturers, retailers of cars, they say, we'll slightly increase the price of certain gas guzzlers, and we'll use that to get the price of electric cars lower and lower, and maybe even hydrogen fuel cell cars, and we should be doing more on the biofuel side, I feel. And so what happens is the marketplace makes it more and more attractive to buy an electric car. And this is what's going on. Norway has these amazing targets for zero-emission vehicles. The sales of zero-emission vehicles, especially electric vehicles, is really skyrocketing in different places here. So, and that's partly to do with policy and partly to do with more and more people realizing that could be a viable option, or they care enough about the planet to make that choice.
Well, let's just finish up here on conservative politicians, because as you've suggested, certainly back in the Stephen Harper days, he certainly didn't appreciate a carbon tax, and you say he didn't bring in regulations that were very helpful either. Do you think we have in Canada today, and let's start in the province of Ontario, where we just elected a Conservative government 7 months ago, do you think that this Conservative government is prepared to put in place regulations that are adequate to the task that, as you've described it?
No. And to me, the obvious thing is that we know about climate policies for three decades now. So if a politician says to you, that guy's policy's terrible, and when I get in, you know, we're going to get together a citizens group, or we're going to package together something, and that's an obvious tell right there that they're not going to do it. And so you know, if you really care about climate change and that's important to you as a voter, you shouldn't vote for them, because they should be able to tell you, oh, we're going to adopt Norway's policy on electric vehicles. It's going to take out electric vehicles in such and such a time frame. We're going to adopt this policy in the electricity sector, and you know, we're going to copy California in this policy, and they're already there, so you don't have to be elected to say this is what I'm going to do. In fact, you should be saying it before you're elected. So what happened was the Ford government came in. I looked at what they offered as an alternative, and people that I trust, economists, some of them people that I've trained over the years across the country in different positions, all looked at it and said, no, they're this is just what we've seen before. It's let's get rid of the sincere policies that will make a difference, and we will leave this problem for future generations.
Well, at the very least, I sincerely want to thank you for coming on to TVO tonight and helping us out with this. That's Mark Kenneth Jaccard, professor of sustainable energy at the School of Resource and Environmental Management, Simon Fraser University. Thanks, Mark.
Thank you. It's been my pleasure.
The Agenda with Steve Bacon is brought to you by the Chartered Professional Accountants of Ontario, helping businesses stay on the right side of change with strategic thinking, insightful decisions, and business leadership. Are you on the right side of change? Ask an Ontario CPA.